Welcome in, Geico Outkick Studios. He typically joins us every single Monday to break down everything going on in the world of college football. He is the loathsome at Joel Klatt. Joel, I understand that some of our Outkick fans have been telling you that they love you on the show. First of all, they should first say, I know that you are the loathsome Joel Klatt, but I appreciate you going on with Clay Travis on Outkick. But is it a bittersweet moment when they say that they enjoy hearing you, but then you find out that they enjoy hearing you on my show?
Yes, I immediately list off other places where they can find any of my work just so that it's not here.
We're talking with Joel Klatt. All right, so we talked all off season, and we've talked about this some on the show, about the importance of college football being played. You fought hard for it, tried to make it happen. And when you see and now are going to get to call the Nebraska-Ohio State game, and we're not that far from the Pac-12 coming back either, but do people even realize how much of a battle it was to get the Big Ten back where now the entire conference is going to be able to play this weekend?
I don't think people realize what low probability this all was, right?
Yeah.
I think that, and I think that's kind of what your point is. You know, let's just put it this way. You know, when we started getting into the July and early August, in particular, like middle of July, I thought it was about a 99.5% chance that we were not going to have the Big Ten or the Pac-12. I thought that there was a decent chance, maybe 10% chance we would get. And this was at like my lowest point, right? Because you and I talked at this point, too. And I was like, I don't know, man. It does not look good. In particular, once you started getting some of those news reports of the Big Ten, so I don't think people appreciate exactly the what we're about to see. How rare, I guess you could say that it is. But you know, I'm happy for these kids that they're going to get a chance to compete. And I think what strikes me now every time I do a game is that Clay. What we've lost, and again, you know, I mean, the bros are out there in force. Every time one person tests positive, or if it's Saban, you know, they're all out there, or a high profile game gets postponed, and they're out there basically standing on a soapbox saying, I told you so. And I always want to say, like, well, what about the other 90% of the games that are going on? What about every one of these players that have opted into the season, right? Like, no penalty. They don't have to be there. And how about the zero players or coaches in college football that have been hospitalized? How about any of that? Like, does anyone want to do an article on that? Anybody at all? The fact that we're going to have Big Ten football, are there going to be challenges? Absolutely. Does anyone want to, like, when is that going to be celebrated and championed about these kids and what they're doing, what they're out there and fighting for? In particular, a guy like Justin Fields, who I think was influential and critical in getting the Big Ten to revisit their decision and to potentially play. I don't know. I mean, so yeah, you hit a little bit of a buzz topic with me, because it is frustrating to see how the sport is covered, and in particular with guys that will go right back to just like writing about college football as if they're covering it normally, and then they'll throw just a haymaker article out there about how we shouldn't be doing it. It's just wild.
Thank you for, like, I have been, obviously, I was fired up about the Nick Saban reaction, because you know, the SEC now, let's use the SEC as an example. The SEC has had 28 games scheduled in the first 4 weeks of their season, and they have played 26. If you were objectively talking with someone back in August and you had said, hey, the SEC is going to try to play an all-conference schedule, first 4 weeks of the season, they're going to schedule 28 games, I think they're going to be able to play 26. Everybody would have been like, man, that's pretty remarkable. That's pretty incredible. Good for them.
But also, also go a step further, right? Go a step further in terms of, like, listen, there will, you know, tell them, like, yeah, there are going to be positives throughout. There are going to be high profile positives, excuse me. But nobody is hospitalized, and no one's even had severe symptoms.
Right.
Like, that's the other part, right? Like, that's the underlying. We all just want to talk about postponements and positive tests and this and that, as if that's the bar.
Right. Like, I agree. I mean, the entire process of a positive test being a big story is to me a flaw of the way we talk about sports in a COVID era, because thankfully the number of athletes or coaches that have had significant issues from a COVID positive test is right now zero, right? I mean,
and we should all celebrate that.
That's right. It's not me trying to be hyperbolic. Like, literally, for people who are playing college football or the NFL this fall or coaching it, we haven't had a single issue with somebody testing positive and having a severe health-related issue associated with it. And so,
let's all hope that that continues. Right. Obviously, but here's the next point. This is not used as a point to win an argument. This is not used as a point to win favor. This is used as a point to hopefully shape our narrative moving forward. This is what drives me so nuts, Clay, is that what data should do in all walks of life is shape the narrative moving forward, shape the policy moving forward. So the fact that we've had positives and postponements and everything, yes, that should shape how we continue to follow protocols and go about our business in college football. But the fact that as of now we have had zero significant issues at all as far as the health impact on any individual in college football should also shape the narrative and the policy moving forward, meaning continue to put one foot in front of the other, be patient, follow protocols, and proceed with the season. It doesn't mean – so I guess what I'm trying to say is, like, everything that has happened this year should put us in a place where we do not get to a sky-is-falling scenario. So when you read an article like that, or when you hear a take that is sky-is-falling, immediately discard it, folks, okay? Because those that are following the sport rationally via the data – we'll tell you that everything is being done right now incredibly well. It is an incredibly successful season, all things considered, as of today.
We're talking to Joel Klatt, Fox's lead college football analyst. I built on that a little bit. I want to circle back because I talked a lot about this. How do people who are writing these, oh my God, these, you know, what I call fear porn, like the sky is falling stories — you hit on it too, but I tweeted about this — Monday through Friday, it's like the sky is falling. There's no way we can play. Oh, my God, Nick Saban tested positive. Oh, my God, they're having to move the Vanderbilt-Missouri game in Florida against LSU and all these things. And then on Saturday, Sunday, it's like they stop the charade there, go to a game, write and talk about it as if nothing is different. And my thing is, like, how can you spend Monday through Friday trying to terrorize everybody, and then Saturday and Sunday you go cover a college football game or you go cover an NFL game and tweet and talk and write about it as if it's no different than any other year? It's like the cognitive dissonance there. I don't understand how it's not more readily apparent to the people who are doing it. But for fans out there, I think that they certainly see it. They're like, if you think it's too dangerous — which it isn't — but if you think it's too dangerous to play football, then isn't it too dangerous for you to travel and go cover a football game? Like, the lack of consistency, the hypocrisy drives me crazy.
Well, I mean, that's exactly right. And it negates the weight of their words from Monday through Friday.
That's right.
As if they're right there covering the game, because people are saying, well, listen, if you weren't just trying to be high, or if this is exactly how you feel, then you should not be in a press box.
That's right.
Period.
And you certainly shouldn't be traveling.
I don't know what else to tell you.
Yeah.
100%. 100%. Which, by the way, and here's the other part of this. If that's how you feel, that's fine.
Yeah.
That's fine. Right? Like, that's the beauty of our country, is, like, if that's your position, that's perfectly fine. But that doesn't mean that everybody has to follow your position. And I find it very interesting that they use their platform to push that type of fear, and then are traveling around the country, sitting in press boxes, covering the sport that they're saying shouldn't exist right now. It doesn't make any sense to me. It really doesn't. And, you know, it's obviously frustrating, but I will tell you this. I'm really thankful for the hard work that all the medical professionals have put in to keeping everybody safe and healthy through college football. We're learning a lot every single day. And that's what Greg Sankey will tell you. That's what Bob Bowlesby will tell you. That's what everyone will tell you, is that we continue to learn a ton every single day. Whether via the antigen testing or the PCR testing or the protocols within all of these teams and individual programs. One of the things that they're learning is that, you know, the hardest thing for them to deal with right now, did you know, and this is fascinating, the hardest thing for them to deal with, it's not even getting kids to not be like, quote unquote, regular college kids. It's when families come to town for home games. The hardest thing programs are dealing with. That's Clay, imagine that, right? Like, I've had four different head coaches tell me that their biggest fear in regards to COVID is not the severity of COVID on their players, but just the disruption to the, obviously, the season and everything and the life of these players individually. And where they're getting it is when their parents come to town for home games, or their family comes to town for home games.
I wouldn't have thought about it, but it makes total sense. I mean, your parents come to town, you go eat dinner with them or whatever, you know, you meet with them in the hotel the night before or after the game. I mean, you want to see, you know, mom and dad want to see their kids, right?
That's right. Right.
Brothers and sisters, and everything
like,
else.
All of these coaches are like, you know, I was really fearful of traveling, and I realized that traveling is the best bubble we have. We clean the plane, we clean the buses, we're around each other, we've all been tested, and we don't see anybody else on the road. It's like, it's a great bubble for us to be on the road. At home is where I get nervous.
We're talking to Joel Klatt, Fox's lead college football analyst. All right, let's go into the games themselves. Alabama, yeah. Just in the second half, shut down Georgia. I mean, yeah. it was something to see, and I know there were some controversial calls and everything else, but Alabama's offense, I mean, Joel, I wrote about this in my starting 11 column. If you think about Henry Ruggs, Jerry Jeudy, and the guys that they have got now that are, you know, Waddle and how talented they are, I think there's an argument to be made that the Alabama last year receiving core is maybe the greatest receiving core that has ever existed in the history of football, college, or NFL. Like, there are no NFL teams with four first rounders. Devontae Smith obviously is the other one. Nobody has that, right? I mean, to think about how good they are, and as good as Georgia is defensively, and eventually they just couldn't cover those guys for the entirety of the game. Who can cover them, or are we just headed for, you know, what looks like a 73-point Clemson, where you're going to have to score 50 points to win the title, and Alabama and Clemson are just going to be standing there like throwing full-on punches at each other?
So I've got a lot of different answers, and I hope they're all good, but they're all very different to this, you know, this topic, because it wasn't, you know, Clay, it's not even really a question as much as a topic, right?
Okay, yeah, right.
So let me start first with like an overarching, like, I believe that in order to win a national championship, you're going to have to get into and win a shootout against another team that has five-star athletes as well.
Yep.
And so that, I think that is the new modern college football. Okay, so here's the next layer of that. Saban realized that against Deshaun Watson, right? Like,
yep.
He learned that lesson, that he couldn't go out there and just muscle his way defensively and run game and all this stuff to a national championship anymore. So he realized, well, okay, we're going to have to go out there and change our offense a little bit. And they've done that. And to an unbelievable degree, as you mentioned, Georgia is 3 years behind on the learning curve, right? Like, they have a team that pre Deshaun Watson could have won a national championship. Wouldn't you agree?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, okay, look, the only thing I would say a little bit different is they did win the shootout game in the Rose Bowl against Baker. Remember when they had a pretty explosive offense that year? They had, I think they both scored 50 or whatever. But yes.
Now, here's the difference, though. The difference being is that you're going to have to play and win a shootout against a team that also has a good defense. Like, I wouldn't categorize that Oklahoma team as a good defense.
That's a good point.
That Georgia offense was able to win a shootout against that Oklahoma team. I'm talking about like a really good Clemson team, a really good, you know, LSU or Alabama, where you're going to have to get into, can you score 45 or close to 50 against the top 15-20 defense?
Yeah.
Right? Like that's
which
really
is what Bama
tough.
Just
Oklahoma
did,
team.
Right? That's what Bama
Correct.
Just did to
that's
Georgia.
That's
yeah.
exactly right. Now, on a flip side of this, you talked about the wide receivers, and you're 100% accurate about the unbelievable core of wide receivers.
Four first-rounders that they had last year, and the two of them they still have this year with Devontae Smith and Jalen Waddle.
And think about this. The only year that they haven't gone to the playoff.
Yeah.
I would argue, and I have for a long time, and even as a quarterback, this might be a little bit heresy, but great wide receivers never win you championships. They're flashy, and they're great. Name a Super Bowl champion whose best player was a wide receiver.
Yeah, Jerry, this is such a fun like bar debate, but to me, Jerry Rice probably is the closest, and I know you had Montana and everything else
but
associated
Montana's
with that.
But Montana's like a top two,
yeah,
three
right.
quarterback
that's,
of all
that's,
time.
That's
right?
why I don't so think you like, can make that argument. I think you're right. I mean, the team to win the Super Bowl, their best player has never been a wide receiver. I mean, I think that's, you know, in 50, whatever it is, 54 years of Super Bowls, I think there's a strong argument that's true.
So I would always say that, like, hey, it's amazing to have great wide receivers. I just don't think that they can be your strength. Last year, what ended up hurting Alabama was the fact that their defense just was not quite good enough. They started to get, you know, banged up at quarterback. Like, these more important areas, in particular, like defensive line, I thought that they didn't play as well as they had in the past. This year, I think that they're better in those areas. And while their defense has been criticized, in particular after that Ole Miss game, I thought that second half was really impressive, very impressive. So, to me, if they are to win a national championship this year, they might have to do that because, or they might have to do that via great wide receiver play. But I still don't think that you can just, you know, offense your way to a championship. And Oklahoma has proven that. Because right now, if you actually look at the metrics, and I've studied some of the analytics with what Alabama is doing offensively, because it's so significant and so amazing. But right now, you know, they're about like what 2018 Oklahoma was. Like, Oklahoma's played offense at this level before. LSU just played offense at this level before. And it's going to take a little bit more to win a national championship, at least in my estimation. And that's why it's so important that they've got Najee Harris, who I think is tremendous. Their offensive line is very good. And it's going to be important that their defense continue to play well as well.
We're talking to Joel Klatt. All right, so with all that being said, would you be very surprised if Clemson and if Alabama were not in the playoff based on what you have seen from those two teams so far?
I would be shocked. Now, who knows what happens with COVID? I mean, yeah. I'd probably be more shocked if Clemson wasn't there, just because the ACC is not even close to Clemson.
Right.
Right. I mean, we saw that in the Miami game. Notre Dame's not going to be close to Clemson. And who knows with the thing about it is, like, in a COVID year, you get the wrong guys testing, you know, getting a positive test on the wrong week. And Ole Miss just proved that, like, hey, Ole Miss can offensively play with Alabama for a little while or most of the game. Georgia can be right there. So because of the strength of the league in the SEC, I would say that I'm not 100% that Georgia's going to go to the playoff, but I'm damn close. I mean, I'm that 98, 90, 99%.
All right, last question for you, and we're talking to Joel Klatt. We'll talk to him again next week, and I know you're excited to have the game Nebraska-Ohio State with the Big Ten coming back. I'm kind of toying around with a thesis theory that because they're all conference games pretty much in the Big 12, the ACC, the SEC, the Big Ten. Well, actually, I got a couple more questions because I actually want to get into this testing thing. So actually, can you come back with us and close out a segment here?
Yeah.
All right, we'll bring Joel back and finish out the hour.